One of the topics I'm really excited to hear from you on is the Big Bang, because I've heard appeals to dark matter from secular scientists, but particularly I want to look at, let's start with, does the Big Bang and the Bible fit together? We'll start with the Bible's teaching and then look at the science on that after that.
Good. Yeah. And that's a good question to ask, because I think a lot of Christians who haven't studied it think, well, you know, the scientists say this is how the universe came into existence. It must be the way God created. No, it's not. The Big Bang is not compatible. Well, maybe I should start by talking a little bit about what the Big Bang is, how it's supposed to have unfolded. The Big Bang is the idea that the universe popped into existence from nothing, from a quantum fluctuation, from another universe, whatever, by whatever mechanism. It popped into existence about 13.8 billion years ago. So the time scale is very different from biblical creation. And when it pops into existence, it's very small. It's smaller than an atom, but immediately expands out very, very rapidly. And as it does so, it carries all the energy. So the universe, all the energy that would eventually become everything else is packed into this little atom, basically, this little primeval atom. And so it expands out. It's too hot for matter because the temperature is outrageous. It's more than you can comprehend, really. It's hard to put a number to it. But the it's so hot, you can't have ordinary atoms and things like that. They would be ripped apart by the energy. So it's just energy, a lot of photons, things like that. As it expands, it cools, and some of that energy becomes matter, things like atoms, protons, neutrons, eventually collecting into atoms and so on. Some of those atoms collect into, gravitationally, they collapse into stars. The stars then fuse the heavier elements, and they explode and release the heavier elements in the universe, and then planets. Some planets form from that and other stars, and then eventually Earth's one of those planets that forms, and then the story takes over from there. You have life evolving on Earth and so on. And that's incompatible with the Bible in many ways. The time scale is incompatible. The Bible says God created in 6 days. It's clear from context. Those are ordinary, approximately 24-hour days, because each is bounded by an evening and a morning and so on.
Right.
And in days when it's light out, God defines it for us. So there's no doubt about that. Whereas the Big Bang requires 13.8 billion years. The exact number changes from year to year as they revise their estimates. But the order of events is different. The Big Bang has stars coming about billions of years before the Earth. The Bible has the Earth being made on day one. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and so on. And then stars are made on day four.
Right.
So the order's different. So even if you tried to make the days long or something like that, that's not going to work. The order's very different. The mechanism's different. The earth is, according to scripture, it's made by God. It's made supernaturally on day one. Stars are later. According to the Big Bang, the earth is made of stardust. When stars explode and release their dust, some of that collects and forms the earth. So the mechanism's different. The time scale, the mechanism, everything is different. And the motivation's different. The motivation for the Big Bang is to try and explain the origin of the universe naturally. That is, or naturalistically, maybe I should say. That is, it's trying to explain how the universe came into existence and how it came to be the way it is today without invoking God. And so that ought to give Christians pause to say, wait a minute, we shouldn't be thinking along those lines, because the universe was created. So it is theologically incompatible with the Bible.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, thanks so much for breaking that down. So there's one point I hear brought up, and there's a lot of discussions with atheists, but also amongst believers as well, is, well, this doesn't seem coherent because the light issue of when was sunlight, and because you have, I think the sun was on day four, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And but then you have four literal days before that, and so the question is always, how could you have a day without light before the sun?
It's not a problem. It's strange that people think, how can you have light without the sun? Well, I have light in here. I don't have the sun in here.
Right, exactly. Just
you can have light without the sun. The sun is a source of light. It's not the only source.
Exactly.
God provided a temporary source of light for those first 3 days. And then some people have the impression, well, wouldn't that affect the length of the day? Right? Because apparently, I don't know. Maybe they think the sun goes around the earth and that causes the length of the 24 hours. No. It's the rotation of the earth that causes the length of the day. The sun has very little to do with it. As long as you have a light source and a rotating planet, you're going to have ordinary day and night. Did we have a light source for the first 3 days? Genesis 1:5 or Genesis 1:3, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. So yeah, we had a light source. Did we have a rotating planet? Well, again, Genesis 1:5, and there was evening and there was morning, day one. So yeah, we had a rotating planet. So you're going to have ordinary day and night for those first 3 days. It's just that God used a temporary light source instead of the sun for those first 3 days to illuminate half of the surface of the earth. So it's not a problem.
Right. I've heard some debate on what the source was. Like some people appeal to revelation to say, well, God's going to be the source and there won't be a sun, right? I don't know if you had any other thoughts related to that.
I avoid speculating on that because the Bible doesn't tell us.
Yeah, that's true.
It happened in the past, so it's not something accessible to science. So I don't think it's God himself. I think it's a temporary light source that he created because he divided the light then. He's not dividing himself.
That's a good point.
Yeah, so it's some temporary light source that we don't have access to today. It's gone. And I think probably the reason God did it that way is so that people would be less inclined to worship the sun as the ultimate source of life, which most ancient cultures did. They worshiped the sun. The Egyptians, they had the sun god Ra and so on. And even the Hebrews, a lot of times they fell into that as well sometimes. But it makes it less tempting for God to just displace it a few days to show the sun's not primary. God's saying, I'm the primary source of life. The sun is just something I made. And he doesn't even call it by name in Genesis. It's just the greater light that rules the day, the lesser light, the moon, the lesser light to rule the night. He doesn't even name them. You name something, it might be a deity. And God's saying, no, these are objects that I created to sustain life that I made in the beginning.
I'm so glad you brought that up because there is no one like God and there's no comparison. And just that point alone that God did everything he does as a perfect reason. And we should never assume that he doesn't have a good reason, even if we don't understand it.
That's exactly right. Yeah. And since God's mind is infinite, there will be an infinite number of reasons for things that we'll never know. And that's why God gave us faith to trust in him. He's a good God. We should trust in him.
Amen. And I think that's so awesome thinking about, well, he is showing all of these false deities are not the true deity. And there's only one through just the order of creation. It's a strong apologetic of the days of creation. And of course our regular work week as well. I'm glad it was not 6 million years, because that would be a long time before we had a Sabbath.
It would.
So yeah, let's get into the scientific issues of the Big Bang, which I think there are many. And I really hope our listeners will continue listening here, because everyone acts like it's settled science. And it's kind of surprising when you start looking at it. Even many apologists, friends of mine, just act like this evidence is so good, but I think we need to take a second look. So let's first, again, starting from the scientific method, does the Big Bang meet that standard?
I guess you could call it a scientific model in this, just because anything counts as a scientific, anything that tries to explain some aspect of the universe and make some kind of prediction as to what's going to happen in the future or a future experiment qualifies as a scientific model. Okay, but it's not a very good one, because a good scientific model makes testable specific predictions about the outcomes of future observations or experiments. Specific predictions. And they can't just be vague. They can't be, if I say, well, sometime tomorrow, something will happen. That's my model. Tomorrow, something will happen. And something, lo and behold, something happens tomorrow. And you say, see, that's proof of my model. No, it's not. That wasn't a specific prediction. If I could predict when lightning would strike, that would be a little better. If I could say lightning will strike this spot right here at 12:47 and 23 seconds. And if it worked, you'd be like, well, you're onto something there, Lyle. It's a good model. The Big Bang really hasn't made any specific successful predictions. The only prediction I can really think of that you might count would be the discovery of the cosmic microwave background, and that requires some explanation. If you could see microwaves and you go outside at night, you'd find the sky would be sort of aglow with faint microwaves coming from all directions in space. And that was discovered in 1964. And in a sense, the Big Bang sort of predicted that, I'll grant that. And those microwaves have a temperature associated with them of about 2.7 degrees above absolute zero. So they're quite chilly. Space is very chilly. And it's been argued, well, the Big Bang predicted about 3 degrees above absolute zero would be the temperature of space. And some predictions, it's true that some predictions did make that. Some predictions predicted lower. Some predictions went up to 50 kelvins above absolute zero. So there's actually quite a wide range of predictions. And one of them happened to be not too far off. So there you go. So there's your one successful prediction of the Big Bang, but it's not very successful because the Big Bang predicted that there ought to be large fluctuations in this cosmic microwave background. But in fact, they're much smaller than the Big Bang predicted, factor of 10 to 100, depending on which predictions you look at. And those fluctuations are necessary to seed galaxies. So that's an issue. So you might say the Big Bang predicted the cosmic microwave background, but that's not a very robust prediction, because any universe that has an average temperature will eventually give off microwaves. And so it's a little bit like the prediction I mentioned earlier, where tomorrow something will happen.
Right.
Any universe will eventually have microwaves in it if it has any kind of energy, because that energy will eventually collect in dust. The dust will re-radiate it. Eventually, you're going to get microwaves. So I think that's not a very good prediction. And the other thing that makes a good scientific model is it's relatively simple. The simpler the model, the better it is. And that people who are not scientists, they get puzzled by that, because they think of a scientific model as being very complex and lots of math and so on. The best models are the simplest. Newton's laws of motion and gravity can be written down on an index card.
Yeah.
And they explain the motion of everything in the universe as long as it's significantly less than the speed of light and so on. Einstein built on that. But that's good science. That's really good science. You can write them down on an index card, or Maxwell's equations, which describe all electromagnetic phenomenon. Four equations, write them down on a card, there they are. It describes all electromagnetic radiation in the universe. That's a good model. The Big Bang is horribly complicated, and it does give an explanation, I would say a wrong explanation, for why the universe appears the way it is today. But it requires lots of fine tuning in order to adjust that without any kind of mind behind that fine tuning to do it. So it's not good science. It's not good science. It's a story about the past that secularists embrace because they have no alternative. The alternative would be creation, and they are unwilling to accept that.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And thanks for breaking that down for us, especially the cosmic microwave background. That really helps, because I think a lot of people are thinking that, well, the biblical creation model, how do you explain that? But as you're saying, it doesn't seem like that's really a problem.
There are lots of different ways you can get microwaves, and I mean, you have an oven that does it. So microwaves are what you get when something radiates, and it's about 3 degrees above absolute zero on average. You're going to get microwaves radiating from it. So I'm not sure that requires much of an explanation. Now, in terms of the details of what in space is exactly giving off those microwaves, I don't think we know for sure. But again, it's not a very robust prediction. The universe will eventually have an average temperature and will give off microwaves. So that could be just what we're seeing right there.
So is it an assumption then to say that's the afterglow of the Big Bang? Because that's
absolutely
what they're assuming. They're saying microwaves are the afterglow.
Yeah. There's no evidentiary basis for thinking that. There's no reason in the evidence why you would have to assume that that's the cause, that the Big Bang is the cause of those microwaves. Lots of things could be the cause of that. And interestingly enough, there's some evidence, and I haven't used this too much because I want to investigate a little bit further to make sure it's really solid. But there's some evidence that the cosmic microwave background isn't really a background, but it's a foreground, that it's much closer than people think, because there's an effect when microwaves travel through galaxies. Some of them get deflected. There's an effect where basically you should see a shadow in the cosmic microwave places where galaxies are. You should see shadows there where the microwaves have been blocked. It's called the Sunyaev-Zeldovich effect. And we don't see that, or at least we don't see nearly enough of it. And to me, the most reasonable explanation of that would be the microwaves are at their source is actually closer than some of those galaxies. So it might be something that permeates space rather than something that exists only at an extreme distance. Mm-hmm. And that evidence, I think, is very contrary to the Big Bang's explanation of the cosmic microwave background. I'll grant, I don't know the detailed cause of it. but there's good evidence it's not the Big Bang.
Yeah, and some encouragement definitely for people to dive into that. That sounds interesting to explore. Now, another reason that people think that the Big Bang happened is, of course, they say the universe is expanding. I hear that's one of the, of course, the others is the weak radiation, the cosmic background we talked about, and distant galaxies seem to be rushing away from us. So what are your thoughts on that then?
The universe does seem to be expanding in the sense that if you're located on any one galaxy, all the other galaxies seem to be moving away from you. Doesn't matter where you're at. Could be on, so it's as if everything's just being stretched out and expanded, like raisins in bread, as you bake the bread and it expands and the raisins all move away from each other. If you want to be a little more precise than that, think of ants or worms moving through the bread. If they're real close to each other, they might be able to overcome the expansion and actually meet. And so there are some galaxies that are very close to ours that are actually moving a little bit toward us, like the Andromeda Galaxy, M31. Because it's so close, its motion through space is greater than the expansion of space between our galaxy and that galaxy. And those are called peculiar velocities. Has nothing to do with being peculiar. It's just there's Hubble flow, which is the overall expansion of the universe, and then peculiar velocities, which are the motions of galaxies in space. And we only see the combined effect in the redshifts of these light. But aside from the very few nearby galaxies that are moving toward us, the rest of them are moving away. And the farther away they are, the faster they're moving away, the greater their redshift. And that would make sense if the entire universe is being stretched out or expanded. I think it is. And I think the Bible actually mentions that. In passages like Isaiah 40:22, it says that God stretches out the heavens like a curtain, spreads them out like a tent to dwell in. And so, and there's many other passages as well in scripture that teach that God somehow stretches out the heavens. He doesn't tell us why, he doesn't give us the reason, but apparently God made the universe with size and he stretched it out a bit since then. A lot of people think that this is somehow evidence for the Big Bang, but it really isn't, because I can imagine God creating a universe 6,000 years ago and then he's stretched it out since then. That would explain the light we see from these galaxies. Perfectly reasonable within a 6,000 year explanation. Not a problem at all.
Right.
I think some laymen think that the Big Bang predicted this expansion. It did not. The expansion of the universe, the fact that galaxies are all moving away, or almost all of them are moving away from us and from each other, was discovered in the 1920s, the late 1920s. Edwin Hubble found the relationship between expansion and distance, or recession velocity and distance, of these galaxies. The Big Bang, the idea that the universe came from a point, was 1931. It was invented by George Lemaître, and he already knew about expansion of the universe. And so my point is, the Big Bang did not predict the expansion of the universe. It was a secular explanation for the expansion of the universe. Now, Lemaître did believe in God, but he held to methodological naturalism. He believed that you should leave God out of the equation when you describe anything, including apparently the origin of the universe. And so he in 1931, came up with the idea that the universe started as a point and then rapidly expanded, and today we're just seeing what's left over. But there is no logical reason to assume that the universe began as a point, as opposed to beginning with size, and it's stretched out just a bit in the few thousand years since creation. So expansion does not support the Big Bang.
Right. Yeah, no, that helps a lot, because to me that always seemed very persuasive. And then I kind of looked in more in depth at scripture, and then I heard some of your videos explaining that. And I always thought it was a necessary requirement. If it's expanding, it must have been smaller. But as you explained it, that doesn't have to be the case. That's not a lot.
It doesn't have to be smaller. It just doesn't have to be.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
not as they're claiming. To me, some of the other ones that I think are really significant it's what's called the antimatter problem. Maybe you can explain that.
Yeah, the antimatter or the baryon number problem, got a couple different names, but remember the story that I told earlier, the Big Bang story, is the idea that the universe, when it's very small, it's just pure energy. You can't have atoms with temperatures that high because they get ripped apart. The energy is too intense. And so as the universe expands and cools, some of that energy becomes matter. Now, atoms, protons, neutrons, electrons, and they form atoms and so on. And we know that energy under certain circumstances can become matter, because we can do it. We can create matter in high energy collisions where we take particles, slam them together, and from that energy, you can get new particles, and including protons and neutrons. You can, the right. constituent parts of atoms. So we know that can happen. But our experiments also show that every time you take energy and convert it into matter, you get an equal amount of antimatter. And antimatter is the same as matter, but the charges of the particles are reversed. So, you know, if you have an atom which has protons in the core and it's got electrons circling around, you can have an anti-atom. An anti-atom would have anti-protons. They're negatively charged versions of protons, and anti-electrons called positrons, which are positively charged electrons circling around it. And so if the universe really did come, if all the matter in the universe really did come from this energy in the Big Bang, there should be an exactly equal amount of antimatter everywhere in the universe.
Yeah.
All our scientific observations have demonstrated that whenever energy is converted to matter, you always get an equal amount of antimatter. There are no known exceptions to this. And therefore, if the matter in our universe came from energy, there must be an equal amount of antimatter, and it's not there. It's not there. Wow. The only place we find antimatter in the universe is where it's produced locally and almost immediately disintegrated when it comes into contact with ordinary matter anyway. Because when matter and antimatter touch, they blow each other up. They release energy. They go back to energy. So the fact that our universe is matter only is very perplexing to the secular scientists. It's a feature of creation, because we would expect that, because if God had made the universe equal parts of matter and antimatter, any place they touch, they explode. They blow each other up. Wow. So it would be a dangerous universe to live in. God made the universe essentially matter only, with only trace amounts of antimatter that are, again, produced locally. It's a design feature, but it's very hard to explain this baryon asymmetry problem. And the best that secularists can do is to propose that once in a while, when energy makes matter, there's no antimatter, it just makes matter. But that's pure speculation. That's never been observed in any experiment. And so it's not something that's supportable scientifically.
Wow. And that sounds like a just so story. once in a while, that's a trigger word right there. And that, to me, that when I heard that explained as you did so well, is that people need to understand this. This doesn't match its predictions, and it has a lot of rescuing devices of just so explanations. You hit at earlier was kind of related to the temperatures and the universe. And I think this is connected with the horizon problem. Maybe you can explain that one.
Yeah, so it's interesting because it's a light travel time problem. And the secularists like to think that creationists have a light travel time problem. How do you get light from those distant galaxies to the Earth within the biblical time scale? Now, we have an answer to that, and I think it's a pretty good one. But the ironic thing is the secularists have the same type of issue, and I don't think theirs is resolvable. It's called the horizon problem. And the idea is when the universe is very small, you know, the size of actually smaller than a grapefruit, you'll have some places that are hotter, it's extremely hot, but you'll have some places that are hotter than others, hot spots, okay? And that's due to the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. It would have to be the case that some places will be hotter than others, just randomly. As the universe expands, those places get pushed far apart. Today, we notice that the universe has almost the same temperature everywhere. Now, it does have small fluctuations in it, but the kinds of enormous differences that were expected, we don't see them. We don't see them. And so somehow, the universe has come to the distant universe, in terms of the cosmic microwave background, has somehow come to the same temperature, or almost the same temperature, to within a very small fraction. But how does that happen? In order for a hot spot to dump energy to the cold spot, it's got to dump it via light, or it could be something else, but everything else is slower than light. So light's the fastest way to do it. It could give light from this object from A to B, and then A would cool off and B would warm up, and you could even out the temperatures. But the funny thing is, even if you give them 13.8 billion years, there's not been enough time for light to travel from A to B even once. Even out those temperatures, let alone the multiple times it would take to really bring them to equilibrium. And so it's a light travel time problem. And it's one that the Big Bang folks have, which I think is very interesting. So they can't really in good conscience chide us for having a light travel time problem when they have the same type of issue. It's not really resolved. Some people think that if you've heard of inflationary Big Bang models,
yeah,
that's an attempt to solve the horizon problem. But basically, a lot of times people think, well, maybe you can make the universe even older. That'll solve the problem. It doesn't.
It makes it worse, right?
Yeah, no matter how big you make the universe, the light from one side of the visible universe is just now reaching us. So it's going to take, obviously, it's going to take much longer to get over there. And yet these two places have the same temperature. How does that happen? And so my secular colleagues have proposed inflation. They say that when the universe is very, very small, the temperatures even out kind of then, and then it suddenly expands at a much, much faster rate and then goes back to the slower rate. And this fast rate is the inflation. And what caused it? Well, some kind of symmetry breaking. Nobody really knows for sure. What caused it to stop? No, well, who knows? And how do you get it to stop everywhere at the same time? That's an issue. So inflation has its problems as well. And not all secular cosmologists believe in inflation because they know it has problems. And so they think that the solution lies elsewhere. But that's the horizon problem. And the thing about these problems with the Big Bang, I take these from the textbooks. I haven't, it'd be perfectly fine for me to analyze and come up with issues myself. But I think this is neat because these are things you can look up in a secular textbook. If they're honest, they'll admit that these are problems with the Big Bang. Perhaps they think they've resolved some or all of them, but they are there. And so you can encourage people to read up on those and learn about the horizon problem, the monopole problem, the flatness problem, the baryon asymmetry problem, and so on.
Yeah, wow, that's awesome. I think that really helps me and hopefully our viewers as well. I think it's so amazing. I'm so glad you brought up the inflation because, again, that's another rescuing device. And I can tell you almost every week when I, log into my phone, I'll see another, we've solved the Big Bang mystery. But I kind of think if you've solved it again, you never had it figured out to begin with, is the funny thing, even without reading the article. And it's always involving some form of inflation that has some unknown cause.
So. Yeah. And the fact that they keep proposing new ones too suggests that the old ones really weren't satisfactory. So you can expect to continue to read those kinds of articles.
yeah. It's a very interesting. I'd recommend people to read your articles on your website, Biblical Science Institute, correct.com.
Yeah. In fact, we have a couple on the Big Bang, some of the topics that we've discussed here. Yeah. So they're on that website, awesome. BiblicalScienceInstitute.com.
Awesome. I want to get in as we kind of, talking a little more related to the Big Bang, but also, as you said, it overlaps with the light travel problem as well. But I've heard you mention and several other scientists mention the mature galaxies and cosmological principle. So that has implications on the light travel problem and also the age of the universe as well. So maybe we can talk about mature galaxies. Because a lot of scientists are saying, when we look at the stars at night, we're seeing stars from billions of years ago, but would you think that's actually the case, though?
I don't. The Bible indicates that God created the entire universe thousands of years ago. And there's a couple different issues there we can discuss. There's the prediction of the secularists that distant galaxies should just be starting to... you should see galaxies in the process of formation. And that's not what we see. In the distant universe, we've taken the Hubble Space Telescope, pointed out there's the Hubble Deep Field, there's the Hubble Ultra Deep Field, about as far out as we can look into space. And you'll find fully designed galaxies there. Spiral galaxies, looks like they're even wrapped, similar to ones nearby. And some people say, well, there are systematic differences. And I'll grant there are some differences, but that's okay. It doesn't. The fact is, these galaxies are not in the process of formation. They're fully designed already at distances that were really surprising. The Hubble Deep Field was shocking to secularists to see these fully designed galaxies at distances where they thought they should just be starting to form. They're not just starting to form. They're there. And they're fully designed. They're mature galaxies at these tremendous distances. So that's a problem for the secular view. With regard to how you get the light from there to here, that's an issue. It's actually easy. It's hard. I found it hard to give a soundbite answer to that because it requires knowing something about physics. But first of all, it's not an issue with any star you see in the night sky. All the stars you see in the night sky are within a few hundred light years. Well, Deneb's 1600 light years away. That's one of the most distant ones you can see naked eye. So they're all well within the 6,000 light year radius that people think we should be able to see. But it turns out that the time it takes for light to get from, say, a distant galaxy to the Earth, so a galaxy you could see in your telescope, for example, that time depend. It's not an objective absolute quantity that's the same for everybody. It's relative. And it turns out that time is relative to two things. One is relative to the reference frame of the observer, his motion and or position depending on various circumstances. And secondly, it's dependent on what's called a synchrony convention, which is how we choose to define what now means in distant space. What now means here is obvious. I look at my watch, that's now. Now's the time, according to my watch, that I make the statement. But what about distant space? How do you define what constitutes now? There's more than one way to do it. And Einstein was well aware of this. He wrote about it. This principle is called the conventionality thesis, or the relativity of distant simultaneity. And the fact that what constitutes synchronized clocks in one frame does not in another. The bottom line is, the time it takes for light to get from the galaxy to the Earth depends on those two things. It depends on the reference frame of the individual and the synchrony convention. From light's point of view, the trip's instantaneous. From light's point of view, every trip is instantaneous because light doesn't experience time. And so you think, oh, that's interesting. So it takes no time at all from the light's point of view. That's interesting. But it turns out you can even do it from our point of view if you use what's called an anisotropic synchrony convention, which is something that Einstein toyed with, although it ended up he ended up preferring a different convention because it makes the math easier. The alternate synchrony convention basically defines now such that light takes no time at all to get from there to here. And now a return trip would take time, but the light doesn't have to return, it just has to get here. Right. And I think the Bible uses this anisotropic synchrony convention when it describes celestial events, because all ancient cultures did. No ancient culture used the modern, what's called the Einstein convention or the isotropic synchrony convention. They didn't subtract off light travel time. When you see something happen, that's when it happens. And I think the Bible is using that language. And it surprises people because they think, well, the one way, you know, the speed of light in one direction should be measurable. It's not unless you make certain assumptions that presuppose the one-way speed of light, ironically. And so it's not something that can be objectively measured without first assuming it. Again, this is called the conventionality thesis. It's been discussed in physics literature for the last century. It's well known among people who are familiar with this topic. It's just most people aren't familiar with the topic. So
right.
I actually wrote a book, The Physics of Einstein, that will bring people. There it is. That's it. Yes,
right,
The Physics of
Super
Einstein.
Good. Yeah.
And the idea is to give people enough knowledge of the physics of Einstein so that in the last chapters there, in the last few chapters, when I talk about synchrony conventions, it'll make sense to them. And they'll see, oh, yeah, starlight's not a problem for biblical creation. God really did create in 6 days. He made the stars on day 4, and their light arrived immediately. It didn't take any time for the light to arrive on the Earth.
Right. Yeah, that's awesome. Thanks for breaking that down. And even as we discussed before, even without that, you have the horizon problem that shows that secularists have a light travel problem on their own end. And so I think they can't just shift the burden of proof there. They have the burden of proof, absolutely, on this issue to make what best explains it in their model. I think the biblical explanation makes the most sense. And then you hit on, too, that I think in Genesis, God, it's described that the light was intended to immediately, the light was intended to immediately be visible to the...
I think it's implied, yeah, because it says, and it was so. And right. Of the thing you mentioned is the creation of the lights to give light upon the earth, and it was so. I think that indicates they immediately gave light upon the earth on that day. So it didn't take any time at all. And that would make sense if the Bible's using this anisotropic synchrony convention. That would make perfect sense.
Yeah, it fits so well.